Hi everybody, this is Bill Kladis, and thanks for joining me here on ImbueFX. Today's topic is going to be a quick tip on how to use alpha erosion inside of your particles. Now, alpha erosion goes by several different names. You may have heard it called as alpha dissolve or black point fading, but no matter what you call it, the concept is basically the same. Instead of multiplying out our alpha like we've typically done in previous tutorials, we're actually going to subtract from our alpha and clamp it. What this is going to allow us to do is to give the impression that our alpha is being eaten away or dissolved instead of simply fading out. So to show an example of this, we can see the particle system on the right here. This is the cigar smoke from chapter 8, I believe, in the flow map tutorial. And it looks good, it's convincing, but what we see in the top here is that the particle fades out very uniformly. Now, this works okay, but some styles of smoke or certain types of smoke actually kind of dissolve from the outside in. So the example on the left here is the same particle system, but with our alpha erosion applied. And what we see here is it loses that soft, smoky quality to it, and it's kind of being eaten from the outside, like we've said before. So to understand how to do this, let's go ahead and go into the material. I'm going to close down this final example here, and I'm going to bring this material window up. Now, this is the same setup that we have from Chapter 8 in the flow map tutorial. I'm just going to make some room by selecting everything that's related to our alpha right before it goes into the vertex color. I'm just going to move this over and make some room. Now, to preview this a little bit better inside of the material editor, I'm going to use my sine wave previewer. And if you've watched any of my tutorials, I think I use this in almost every one of them. It's very, very useful. What we're going to do is drop in a sine wave and then look for a time expression for our input. Plug that time into sine. Now this is oscillating from 1 to negative 1 space. So let's go ahead and change this period to 5. This is going to slow it down so it's not so quick. And let's bring in our constant bias scale. This is going to scale it out from 1 to negative 1 and bring it to 1 to 0 space. So we've got that set up. Let's go ahead and bring this in right where our vertex color is going in. Now this fade that we see here on the left, even though it's kind of happening slowly, this is exactly what we're seeing typically in almost every tutorial I've done. We're just fading out the particle very linearly, and every part of it, no matter how bright it is being faded at the exact same amount of time. So let's change this up a little bit, and let's go ahead and delete this multiply, and let's bring in a subtract. So I'm going to search for subtract. And now I'm going to take this lerp here, which is our alpha channel ultimately. I want to plug that into A, and I want to make sure that this is going in the top because we're going to subtract away from it. So remember, order of operations is important. And just for previewing purposes, let's go ahead and bring in our sine wave previewer and plug that into B. So let's plug this result now that we've subtracted into opacity and see what we get. It's starting to work. We can see that the white values are being eaten away. However, we see a really, really nasty black border happening or black mat in the background. What's happening here is that we have values that are going below zero, and those negative values are screwing up with our alpha channel. So we need to clamp it to say, hey, I don't want you to ever go below zero so we get these erroneous results. So we're going to search for constant clamp. Let's go ahead and drop that in there. And let's put the constant clamp in between from our subtract expression to our opacity input in our material. So now this is looking pretty good, right? We can see that we've got a clean matte background, and this is the basics of alpha erosion. So let's go ahead. I want to be able to control this with our vertex color alpha right here. Let's go ahead and duplicate this just for a little more organization. We no longer need our sine wave previewer, so let's go ahead and plug in the vertex color alpha into subtract B. Now right away this disappears, and this is kind of a red flag, but let's go ahead and compile this and see what we get inside of Cascade. We do see some smoke textures, but we can see that it's not really being controlled the way we want it. There's some funny things that are going on, the way it's popping right here. And what's happening, there's actually two things. The first is that we've got some different values here from our previous flow map tutorial that aren't really working with this kind of material setup. So we do have to do some changes here. So let's go into our init color, which is setting the start value of our alpha. Right now it's a range from 0.6 to 0.2. Let's just change that to constant and leave it to 1. Let's also take our other init color, change that to constant and set it to 1. And then our scale color over life modules, which are shared. If I graph this, let me move this over just so I can see, make a little more room. If we graph this and do fit view to all, we can see this second point right here, which is supposed to fade the particle in a little bit, is only set to 0.4. So let's set that to 1. Now it's kind of doing some backwards things now. This is a little bit of strange magic that's happening here, because at the bottom, the particle is just visible a little bit, like completely disappears, and then comes back again and then pops off. And this is partly with the way the material is set up as well. So what's happening here, if you follow the logic, it's actually pretty simple. This value of 1, which is coming out of our vertex color, which is supposed to be completely opaque, is actually being subtracted, which is bringing it closer to black. So remember, values of black are more transparent. So we actually need to invert this so that it behaves properly. So let's go ahead and search for 1 minus, which is our inverter expression. You can also hold down O on the keyboard and then click, and it'll bring in a 1 minus as well. And then let's go ahead and invert our alpha channel, and then bring that inverted value into our subtract. So now we can see that it's popped in. It's looking pretty good. Let's go ahead and compile and see what that looks like inside of Cascade. And it looks much better. It starts off, you know, much more opaque, and then it dissolves as it gets towards the top. Now, there's one other thing that I really don't like, and that's I don't still have that level of control where I want to make the particle a little more transparent, right? So there are several different ways you can approach this. You could remultiply the alpha over here with the vertex color before it goes into opacity. But like we've learned before, dynamic parameters are actually really useful inside of Cascade. And we happen to have one that's free, right? We used 3 of them for our flow map uses 2 of them. We've got that blur control that's using the last one. But parameter 3, which is the blue channel, is wide open. So let's go ahead and duplicate this. Bring this over by our constant clamp. Hold down M to bring in a multiply. And let's multiply this now by parameter 3. And then bring that result into opacity. We won't see anything change in here, because remember, this is a default preview value of 1. Let's go ahead and rename it for organization purposes. And we'll just call this our alpha control. And now let's go ahead and compile this. Now it will disappear completely, and that's okay, because remember, the default values for the dynamic parameter module inside of Cascade are always 0. So we've got these 4 right here. Remember, we connected the third one, which is 0, 1, 2, actually, so don't be confused by that. Let's go ahead and open that up and then change this default value to 1. So now this pops back in, but what we can see is if we do a value of 0.2, let's say, it did fade it out without affecting the alpha erosion that we're learning to do. So this is giving us independent control between the two. So we need to go into our dynamic parameter module on our second emitter and change that to 0.2 as well, maybe 0.25. Make it a little more opaque. So that gives us a lot of control, and that's actually going to wrap up our tutorial, but feel free to play around and explore the different options, because this is just kind of the tip of the iceberg. So for example, instead of subtracting the vertex color, you could actually have the vertex color being multiplied against another texture, so like a repeatable cloud texture like we've used, and that is what gets dissolved. So you actually get some different kind of dissolving patterns, right? You could also set up a version of this and then lerp between a regular version that we're multiplying against, so you get some fading between the two. So again, there are a lot of possibilities. Feel free to explore. But this is the basics of how to do alpha erosion, which again gives you a little different approach and different style to doing fading particles. So I hope you found this useful, and hope you join us for future tutorials. This has been Bill Kladis, and thanks for joining me here on MBUFX.